Warning! This video features flashing lights and showcases these stroboscopic effects, which can cause epilepsy. When somebody breaks into your property, what do you think is a suitable option to scare them off? The obvious way is a siren that creates a super loud signal tone and thus informs other people about the break-in. But another option, which I think is pretty effective, is a bright blue stroboscope light, which not only turns your property into a temporary nightclub, but also messes with the vision of the intruder. So in this video, I will show you how to create an intruder-scaring powerful LED stroboscope. And while we're at it, learn a bit about these stroboscopic effects. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB. From quick turn class to production class, they offer great quality and service. So feel free to test out their PCB quality and delivery speed for only $2. First off, what exactly makes up a stroboscope? Well, in a nutshell, it consists of a light source and a driver circuit that periodically illuminates the light source for a very short amount of time. Due to those quick energy bursts or flashes, we create an optical illusion that make objects look like they are moving in slow motion. But besides this nightclub application, there's also a scientific application. If we, for example, take a motor, attach a disc to its rotor with a marking and let it spin with an unknown RPM, then it would look something like this on camera. But if we now create a stroboscope light out of a high power LED, a MOSFET with suitable driver and a function generator, and slowly increase the pulse frequency of these stroboscope lights, then the disc would slowly start to look a bit strange. And at a pulse frequency of 35.13 Hz, it looks like the marking of the disc is frozen in time, which is known as the stroboscopic effect. The reason for that is while before we saw all the positions of the marking during a rotation, now the stroboscope light with its pulse frequency matches the rotation frequency and thus only illuminates the disc when it is starting a new rotation. That means the pulse frequency is a multiple of the rotation frequency, which after doing a small examination seems to be correct. And just like that, we can visually determine the rotation speed of a motor. Awesome! But how can we build a stroboscope light at home without utilizing a big and bulky function generator? To do that, there are two mainstream options. The first one is the microcontroller route, whose frequency and energy pulse time I was able to adjust with two potentiometers according to this simple schematic. And I even reached down to a pulse time of only 50 microseconds at a frequency of 30 to 50 Hz. Such a small pulse time is recommended by various stroboscope lights I found online. But then again, why bother with programming when you can use a 555 timer as the second only hardware route? According to this schematic, I was able to adjust the pulse time and frequency through two potentiometers as well, but only got down to a pulse time of 3 milliseconds, which is 60 times longer than the Arduino. But after doing some extensive testing with both circuits and my white high power LED, I have to say that the 555 timer is definitely sufficient for my intruder defense system. So after I was sure that the circuit did work without any problems on the breadboard, I soldered all of its components onto a perf board and afterwards to one another according to the schematic. But I did not solder the potentiometers to the perf board, because I will have to mount them somewhere else later on. And once the circuit was complete, I did a small test with it and moved on by choosing a different LED light source. Since I think blue LED light is the most annoying one, I got myself three blue high power LEDs for testing, a 20 watt one, a 30 watt one, and a 100 watt one. But we cannot simply connect them to a power source without a proper heatsink, because the fast rising temperature would destroy the strings of small LEDs inside them. So I got myself a big aluminum sheet with a thickness of 7 mm. Onto it I marked 3 12 mm squares and started cutting them out one after the other with a handsaw. But since I got lazy at the end, I passed on the last cut and thus got one bigger heatsink, which I will use for the 100 watt LED. Next, I positioned the LEDs in the center of the heatsink, marked the mounting holes onto it, drilled them with a 3 mm drill bit, countersinked the holes afterwards, cleaned the heatsinks as well as the LEDs with acetone, distributed heatsink platter onto the LEDs, and finally mounted them to the heatsink with M3 bolts and self-locking nuts. To power them, I got myself this overkill boost converter that can output up to 90 volts and a power of 1500 watts. So I connected the output of this converter in series to a multimeter and the LEDs, in order to increase the voltage until I reached the nominal current flow of the LEDs according to this chart. As you can see, they are all insanely bright, but doing this comparison in my lab is not fitting. That is why I drilled more mounting holes into the heatsinks, as well as two holes in the backside wall of my garage, added plastic dowels and mounted the LEDs there one after the other in order to power them and observe the light output from the front side of my garage. Now everyone got their personal taste, but for me the 100 watt one was the most suitable for the job. That is why I added a distribution box next to it to the wall, in whose lid I mounted the potentiometers of the stroboscope circuit. After then wiring everything up, like it's shown in this final simplified schematic, and stuffing the 555 timer circuit inside the box, it was time to scare some intruders. As you can see, the stroboscope effect is definitely there, but while looking from the outside once again, the light source seems dimmer. The reason is that it is only illuminated for a small amount of time, which on the other hand means we can increase its voltage and current flow a bit to compensate for that. And don't worry, due to the long off time, the LED can handle that. But anyway, with that being done, the first part of my new security system for my garage is installed, and I hope you're looking forward to the conclusion of it in another video, in which I will also have to replace the overkill boost converter. Until then, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!